From lunch. Before we start our first panel, I want to acknowledge the person who really pulled this all together by himself, basically, in 1 month, and that's Stephen Schmidt. He really did a great job. And we decided on these three panels because they really do seem to fit in the circle. I think we're all here because we've had in the past, or we had some kind of experience, practice, that sparked an interest in going into something more powerful, divine, deeper, whatever word you want to use. That led us to wanting to investigate that, to inquire into it. That led to research. And then we thought, I want to teach this. So we taught. And out of teaching, we had more experiences and practice. And it's become this circle of practice, research, teach, practice, research, and teach. So those are the themes of the three panels. This is our first panel on transpersonal education. They will introduce themselves, so I'm just going to let them take it off. Thank you.
Hey, good afternoon. So I'm the first to speak. So my name is Bernadette Blin, for those who were not here this morning. I am the president of Eurotas, but this is not the reason why I'm talking this afternoon. Stephen asked me, you know, to share some principles about the transpersonal education based on my own experience. So I've been teaching psychotherapy and different things like that for about 30 years, and more recently in the transpersonal. So I founded an institute in France, which name is IRET, and I took some time, and I hope I will have time to share these different points I wanted to share with you about this, what is important for us in the experience we have in this institute. First thing is I would like to make a kind of a parallel with what Graf Durkheim said about what he called small therapy and big psychotherapy. And in the same kind of idea, I would like to speak about pedagogy or teaching as a big pedagogy. Transpersonal education for me is in parallel with what he said, Graf Durkheim said, about a psychotherapy that connects you to your true self instead of just transmitting something which will adapt you to the society, which is unhealthy and balanced. So for me, transpersonal education as to also connect you, you know, to this higher self, to this transcendence. One point, so I try to go very fast. So the first point I want to mention is the importance of experiential dimension. So even when we have to teach something about theory, about psychopathology or whatever, we try as much as possible to offer a space for experiencing, because if you just have a knowledge in your mind, you know, you can have a brilliant mind but no ability to connect with the other, to connect your heart and to from your heart to connect the other's heart, because we are training psychotherapists and they will have to work with human beings and not only with the mind. So the experience is a way of, you know, integrating the knowledge and theories and or any type of a teaching we want to give them. Through experience, we also will help them, students, to create an active healing field. And this comes from experience and also from the body, because the body is the vehicle through which our experiences happen. I think that personally, that transpersonal without a body, if I can say that, will stay superficial and an illusion. So it's very important that people, when they enter and when they develop transpersonal experiences, education, they also are grounded. So we will never teach anything without taking the body into account. And we, in this institute, we ask people to have a body practice besides the teaching, can be yoga, tai chi, or whatever, but this is very important. And also, the body is important as a place of listening. I mean, it's listening from your body, like a radar, which will catch, you know, the information from the people in front of you, and also from the relationship, from the field that we both created. So it's the same thing in a class than it can be in a psychotherapeutic session. We can learn how to use our body, you know, as an informational space. Another point is our transpersonal pedagogy teaches what I would say a two-track vision. One is focused on the academic knowledge, and this is important as we know, but if there is not the other side, it will be not relevant. And the other vision, the other track, is opening the non-ordinary level of consciousness, or what Stan called this morning holotropic states of consciousness. So I will not develop this part because we have heard about this. Another of our teaching priority is also based on developing students' creativity. And that's also an important part. We don't just give knowledge and expertise, but we want to help them to open up to or to reconnect with their own creativity and innovation. And as trainers, we really believe in the students' inner potential. And we are not only in contact with their personality and their facade, but also with their soul and their inner being. And this is important because this is what they will be invited to do with their future clients. Not only seeing what they are, but also reflecting on who they are. another point is in a transpersonal education, it's not only, as I said, about knowledge or know-how, how to do, but also how to be. And there is an important part of the teaching which is focused on, you know, the how you are, your inner being, and that's terrible. Okay, well. Oh, no, I look at the other side. Searches on the other side.
You say which side would you tell, like?
No. Okay, creativity. That's terrible. Okay, so what I will not speak about is collective intelligence and the horizontal process of learning instead of you know, vertical process. The teacher is not only an expert, but he's a facilitator, and both the teacher and the students co-create a field and innovate or create new understanding. And last point, but I think it's also important, you know, for us, for the teachers, to help the student get in touch with what is, of course, beyond the ego, and what I would say with the mystery, because it's always more than what we think it is. And staying, creating, or we always must keep a space available for the unknown and what I would call the unknowable. So I skip on this, and the last point, even two last points. In transpersonal psychotherapy and transpersonal education, we are not only focused on the past, the traumas, the wounds, but also on the resources, on self-actualization. That's it. Enough. And the last point I'm really interested in is what we call the therapist anthropology. By that, I mean that as psychotherapists, we are working with all our belief system, all the visions that we have introjected from our parents, environments, and so on. And it's very important for us to understand and to see clearly what are these beliefs so that we can all adjust them in case they are inappropriate or to use them in a better way, to be more efficient. Because very often, you know, people think the way they see the other, the vision of the human being in place in the universe and so on, is shared by everybody, but this is not what it is. So based on our family origins and so on, you know, we carry within us a certain anthropology, and this is for me also something that we have to be very clear of. And my very short conclusion is that, you know, instead of education in a transpersonal way is more like, for me, a path of transformation and a real initiation. That's it. Thank you. Good luck.
I'm Glenn Hartelius. I'm associate professor here at Sophia University. I also teach courses at Middlesex University, have been associated with CIIS, Naropa, and a community college in Oakland. And so I've taught at the undergraduate, the master's, and the PhD level. And the thing that stands out to me about where transpersonal can fit, can contribute to education, is really at the core of its expertise. The ability, the interest in different states of mind, and how to define them and how to use them is at the heart of transpersonal psychology. And I was talking about this with at home last night with my wife, and since I have learned to footnote, I have to reference her and say that she just fed back to me exactly, yes, that's it, that's right. You know, and that when transpersonal psychology started, it was really about altered states for transcendental purposes. But now, it can also use that same expertise for states that are very much about being here and about optimal functioning, about doing what we do in the world and doing it better. Focus, concentration, attention, relaxation, presence, empathy, all of these things have to do with how you shift your way of being. The work that I do with attention looks at attention in a different way, looks at it more in a transpersonal way. Attention in our normal way of thinking, attention is, if you say, where is your attention? You say, well, my attention is on such and such. And what we're doing is we're pointing out where the attention is going. But we're not paying attention, we're not noticing where the attention is coming from. And when we look at where the attention is coming from, and we begin the process of feeling that aspect of the mind, and then being able to move ourselves out of that normal cognitive head-based state that only looks at the mind as content, that only looks at the mind as cognition, then we begin to be able to feel our own presence and where we are. As we do that, it becomes possible to shift the mind, to come quickly out of that state of busy mind into a quiet and focused place. I've used this with students from the undergraduate to the graduate level with good results. And the thing is, because the transpersonal deals with the whole person, It doesn't just deal with the mind that is up here. As Bernadette said, the body is also an informational space. But not just sitting in the head and getting information from the body, but actually inhabiting the body. Not just acknowledging the whole person, but being the whole person. And that opens the ability to understand and describe what it is to focus the mind, what it is to get into a state of quiet concentration, what it is to get into a state of mindful meditation, not just for the sake of evolution or for the sake of achieving contact with something transcendent, but for the sake of being able to show up, study, comprehend, perceive, be present with another person, hold a room. All of those things are aspects that a more whole-bodied, embodied, transpersonal approach opens. So I think that the basic skill set, the basic interest of transpersonal psychology is very applicable, and that as we turn and begin to do research on these kinds of things, and I very much enjoyed the presentation this morning, and one of the good things about transpersonal is it allows for diversity, and I'm actually of the position that what we bring to science is actually of benefit to science. In other words, we're bringing a different way of analyzing. We're bringing the ability to study things that can't be studied from ordinary presuppositions. And as we do that, we can actually contribute to where science is going. There's a sense in which, as was noted this morning, transpersonal field was well ahead of the curve on a number of important areas that are just coming to the fore now. And it's true that these were not popular within mainstream for a long time, but mainstream is coming around. And I think that we have a lot to offer by owning both the traditional topics that we have and bringing them in an empirical work and doing the research that is necessary to make those topics relevant and within a frame that is uniquely transpersonal. Thank you.
Hello, everybody. My name's Jacob Kaminker. First of all, let me say it's an honor and humbling to be up here with and in this room with so many transpersonal heroes. I am an alumni of ITP. I'm also core faculty at John F. Kennedy University. We have three campuses in the Bay Area, Pleasant Hill, Berkeley, and San Jose, and we have both clinical and non-clinical programs with holistic and transpersonal orientations with specializations in transpersonal, somatic, expressive arts therapy. We also, in the fall, we're launching a Jungian depth psychotherapy program, a licensed track program. And we also have, it looks like a PhD, non-clinical PhD in holistic studies on the horizon moving forward. So. We are somewhere where the transpersonal is alive and well in the Bay Area, and I tend to think that in this community will continue to be alive and well in some form. So, for the record. I teach, among other things, transpersonal counseling and Jungian psychology and paradigms of consciousness. So I teach therapists. That's the angle that I'm looking at transpersonal education from. And I wanted to look a little bit today at how transpersonal education can reflect transpersonal ideals, particularly compassion and openness, and how that happens through content and through process. So content is a bit simpler because it's about discussing transpersonal subject matter and building out conceptual frameworks for transpersonal concepts, exploring the legacy of ancient and modern spiritual systems as they describe consciousness and the relationship to the great mystery, and education around diversity issues, as Glenn was saying, and particularly one thing that I think we're unique in is spiritual diversity issues, so non-ordinary states. And that's something that nobody else, I think, is doing quite as well as we are yet. So as far as process goes, that's the pedagogy. That's about, like Bernadette says, direct experience. Whole person engagement in the classroom, mind, body, spirit. So in practice, that's about providing experiential activities that directly explore the content domains that are being explored, so showing, not telling. Inviting students to check in with all of their different levels of experience. So as long as we're footnoting, I'll footnote Ray Greenleaf in offering this quote. This is Carl Jung.
He won't give you more time, you know.
And that's all we have. Okay. So Jung, anyone who wants to know the human psyche will learn next to nothing from experimental psychology. He would be better advised to put away his scholar's gown, bid farewell to his study, and wander with human heart through the world. There, in the horrors of prisons, lunatic asylums and hospitals, in drab suburban pubs, in brothels and gambling hells, in the salons of the elegant, the stock exchanges, socialist meetings, churches, revivalist gatherings, and ecstatic sex, through love and hate, through the experience of passion in every form in his own body, he would reap richer stores of knowledge than textbooks a foot thick could give him. And he will know how to doctor the sick with real knowledge of the human soul. That's beautiful. Thank you, Carl and Ray. So the client, the student, they're the experts on their own experience, and we merely help to guide the process of self-discovery. So in everything we do, we can strive to promote that egalitarian ideal. So we're practicing and encouraging the humility to see ourselves and encouraging our students and clients to see themselves as wounded healers. So that's about the courage to acknowledge one's own wounds as they're activated, as they show up in the world, and also to invite the inner healer of the client and to not overly identify with the healer just because we're being put into that role given the nature of the situation, the circumstance. So what comes to mind is the image of Jesus washing the feet of his disciples and hanging out with prostitutes and lepers considered to be the lowliest of society. But it's an acknowledgement that humility heals. So it's an attitude towards training empathy. And transpersonal educators can practice and model these ideals. So James Hillman says that psychotherapy has set itself up as helping or pacifying the disturbed, but he calls this a progressivist fantasy, though, and that the idea that we'll make things better, easier, softer, more dealable or copable, but sometimes the psyche upsets us in order to go further. So healing comes from the openness and acceptance to the whole range of human experience, from the traumatic to the transpersonal. And that transpersonal education in my opinion, should strive to not only teach but practice from that belief that we're all in this human experience together, and we're all bravely facing the unknown.
Hello, Les Lancaster. I introduced myself this morning as current president of the ITA. But for this panel, let me say that I've been very involved in education, obviously. I'm emeritus professor of transpersonal psychology at Liverpool John Moores University and academic dean in transpersonal studies for an organization in the UK called Professional Development Foundation. Well, I guess most of you are one way or another involved, either learning, well, we're all learning, and I'm interested in what comes out from you in this panel, and I agree with just about everything that's been said. Another role that I have is that I am chair of the section in transpersonal psychology of the British Psychological Society. Now, you know, I was just thinking whether I was going to say all these kind of these hats and these things that I do, these responsibilities, and it's not just to make aggrandizement, but the one thing that comes across most strongly, I feel, when I think about education in this area, is the importance of our connections. And there was a question earlier, which is why I mentioned about the British Psychological Society. Ted, I think, raised this point, because obviously transpersonal psychology is not part of the APA. It is part of the British Psychological Society. Why that should be is a whole question in its own right, and it would be several humorous stories if I wanted to tell you them. But it is important. It is important, and I think this links also to what Glenn was saying about our relationship to science. So I've been involved with many other areas in the academy. Obviously my background's in neuroscience. I mean, I'm involved with the British Psychological Society and a broad range of connections. That's what I try to bring to the people I teach in this area. Of course, you know, experience, no question. It's all about balance. There's a scholarly discipline here. Experience is at the heart of it. But I want to make sure that when I stand up and when my students stand up in company with those who are not necessarily in the sandbox of transpersonal psychology, that they can hold their own. Educationally, so I set up a course, this is going back 20 years, in the UK in consciousness and transpersonal psychology. And I always saw that as a kind of interesting balance because, as I say, by training, background as a neuroscientist, and that, you know, when I look at consciousness, what it comes to me is that there is more. Certainly, I'm not a reductionist. I'm running a workshop tomorrow in Kabbalistic psychology. I'm very interested in areas of mysticism and practice. And certainly, you know, getting across to students that importance of practice and experience. But at the same time, exactly what Glenn said, we have something very valuable to bring to a broader range in the academy. What is our discipline? You know, academically, we talk about disciplines. How disciplined are we in our approaches? This links in, actually, there's another panel last week in there about research and what does it mean to be a researcher in this field. So let's just leave that for the moment. In terms of teaching, well, very famous aphorism everyone I'm sure knows. I learned some from my teachers, I learned more from my fellows, I learned most from my pupils. It's very true, and in my heart I am a teacher. I currently am running a course which is based in the UK, but it's online, so it's global. It's focusing on professional development, bringing in transpersonal psychology most strongly. What's that about? Why is it focusing on professional development? Because I want to see the insights and the values in transpersonal psychology in the world, in the professional arena. That what we have learned, what we have studied as transpersonal psychologists is something that is needed in the areas of professions. And again, I agree with Glenn, because you mentioned about being present. What does that mean? What does it mean when you're present with other people in a creative and productive way? You mentioned compassion, central. You know, so much is changing in the world of psychology and therapy and in those other professions. Mention of 1 minute? 1 minute. Okay. Mention of mindfulness. No, that came up this morning with Jim. And the problem with mindfulness out there in the health world, in the business world, and it's all exploding. The problem is they don't know the first thing about where these techniques are coming from. And there's a backlash. You know, a good friend of mine, he's a Tibetan Buddhist, and they have a whole outfit running meditation class and so on. They've got a problem. The problem they've got is they're getting inundated by people who are kind of off balance, and they're being encouraged. You know, that they were in some area of the health system taking medication or whatever they were doing. They're now being encouraged to drop all that because mindfulness is the panacea. So people do not understand the spiritual and the mystical background of these things. And that's where where are the transpersonal psychologists? Because what transpersonal psychology is above all else, this is my view, and I say it here because it's about education and that's what I want to teach. What transpersonal psychology is about beyond anything else is having your feet in two areas, at least two. And that is, you know, the psychology, the scientific world of psychology, but also these wonderful, great wisdom traditions. And too often, we get these potted versions. And so, and that's the other point. I just want to maybe finish with this. You know, when I said that I have different connections, I've taught these areas of consciousness studies, transpersonal psychology, in a major university, huge, big, large student body and so on. And the great advantage of that is that I draw on other people's expertise. It's not an island. It's integrated. It's connected. And that's what I want my students to recognize and to go out into the world and know where to look for these sources of insight. Thank you.
My name is Ingrid Indane, and I come from Latvia. It's an eastern country near Baltic Sea, far away, just one square centimeter on the map, but very strong country, believe me. And I'm very proud that I'm here and I can represent my country here. I'm also Eurotas board member, and also the board director of Latvian Transpersonal Association of Psychology and Psychotherapy. Last year, in the end of last year, we founded our first education enterprise. It's Latvian Transpersonal Education Institute, and this is first such kind of education enterprise in Latvia. So just now we are preparing our first program. It will be a four-year vocational program, and we hope to begin it in the beginning of next year. So, but I would like to share a little bit with you how we got so far. So, when I was a teenager myself, and if somebody asked me, if you had lots of millions of dollars, what would you do? And my answer was, I would change the education system. make it more spiritual, more opened, especially because I grew up in a Soviet country and everything was under Soviet rules, under the rules of Communist Party. My greatest dream was to get internal and external freedom, to be happy. I was a rebel, a dissident. And I wanted really to study psychology, but my mother warned me that she told me, don't do it because you will have to serve the communist regime in this case. And she was true. So I took the second choice and I went to study in Arts Academy. And I studied visual arts, painting and arts pedagogy. And I got my master's degree, but then Latvia became free. And so I could realize my first dream. I went to study psychology. In the beginning, I was really very happy that at least I could do it. But then I recognized some few strange things that some of my professors told that, okay, if you have a client and he or she is interested in spirituality, then it's a borderline personality. I was really shocked, and not me only one. My classmates also were shocked. And so I thought, how can I work as a psychologist, a psychotherapist, if I must learn such things and implement in my work? And so I was very happy when I met transpersonal community, and that was about 10 years ago or a little bit more. I started to attend Eurata's conferences, and 2 years ago we even organized Eurata's international conference in Latvia. And the interest in transpersonal items grew more and more because, as I told you, Latvians, in their essence, they are transpersonal. Because we have still alive our myths, our fairy tales, very strong magical folk songs. Fairy tales about three levels, the down level, the middle level, upper level. They're traveling between these three levels. And so they just didn't know that they are transpersonal. And how? So I had worked with myself as well and looked for my spiritual path, and I recognized that it's very, very important. It's a great, great resource for me, for my growth. So, and I can't use it, so it means I was taught in university that. So I found that transpersonal psychotherapy is the best way for me. And so just now we are on the way for our first education institute, as I told you. I hope we'll be successful. And so from my experience, the basic things I can tell you for us to create this program is, the first thing is that Latvians themselves are very spiritual, and this is the right time where to bring from the unconscious to the conscious living, to conscious, to contemporary world, contemporary education and scientific research, to bring up these hidden things, which actually were preserved in Soviet times, so they didn't escape, they were preserved somehow. So that's the first thing, the interest in the national country. The second thing is, of course, it's international cooperation. Without that, I couldn't start this big project if I hadn't my colleagues in Estonia, in Italy, in France, in Russia, and of course in United States. So the other thing is cooperation, international cooperation, because only knowing all the things, all how the things the education is developing all over the world, we can find our values of our small national country. And so, returning to my teenager dream, so I didn't get millions and millions of dollars. But instead of that, I got wonderful cooperation partners, that's even more, maybe. I can't change the education system of the world, but I can start and do a small step in my country. And that's really what I can do in my life, and I'm very happy about this. Thank you that you are.
Yuri Bishomsky, president of the Estonian Transperson Association. Chapter 1, the problem. When we went to school, how many teachers have touched our soul? How many teachers have touched our heart? 3, 2, or maybe 0? If we go to a school today, any school around the world, and we ask the pupils, do you love school? How many of them will say that they love their school? So I'm asking the teachers, how can you look your pupils in the eyes? Chapter 2, solution. the solution is transpersonal education, because as my friend Maikov said, education is the best tool to start changing humanity and the world around us. So when transpersonal education starts, the subject of prenatal transpersonal education is only under development. So I'm going to talk with you about kindergarten. I want you to imagine a kindergarten when we're going to teach children to meditate. I promise you, attention deficit disorder is going to disappear. I want you to imagine a primary school when we start each day with sharing and talking about feelings. How do you feel? Anything you want to share? What happened in the family? What are your dreams? What are your fears? What makes you happy? What makes you sad? I want you to imagine a secondary school when pupils are put in groups of 5. And it works like that. Wherever there is an exam, you are not receiving individual mark, you receive the collective mark of your group. In these groups of 5, each student has a strength in another subject. And we are responsible for each other. We're teaching cooperation rather than competition. If you want to see what competition has done, just look at the state of capitalism. Sorry, but this is the result. Now, education has known too many revolutions and too many reforms. No other system knew so many reforms and revolutions. So let's forget about it. Let's see what has not been done. Since Plato and Socrates during the Greek time, Jean-Jacques Rousseau, Makarenko, Rudolf Steiner, Maria Montessori, Janusz Korczak, there are so many philosophers and educators that I have not even mentioned. They sat, and Krishnamurti, that have created the most amazing philosophies on education. And they always stayed somewhere in the fringe, in the sidelines. Why they have not caught the mainstream? Because there's one thing we have forgotten. We have forgotten to ask the customer what the customer wants. And I want you to imagine that we take a group of teenagers in different parts of the country or the world. We're going to talk to them about mission, passion, and compassion. And then we tell them, you've got 1 week to reach a group decision about what kind of school you would like to have. What would you like to learn? How would you like to learn it? And who would you like your teachers to be? We never ask them what they want. We are so arrogant that we know better than them. So if this is the situation in schools, why we keep sending our children there? Because we're hoping when they grow up, they're going to find a transpersonal psychotherapist or transpersonal psychologist. They're going to fix the long life damage that was inflicted on them. So yes, I've got my institute and I'm training transpersonal psychotherapists, but what are we doing? We are fixing a long life damage that was created by the so-called educational system. Now, when I'm actually lecturing about this subject, different countries in the world, one of the criticisms is that young people don't know what they want, so we need to tell them. But another criticism is the system will never approve schools like that. It's true. The system will never approve schools like that. Why do we need approval of the system? Let's occupy education. Let's take the education into our own hands. Let's not wait for other people to recognize us or accredit us. Because education is the future of our humanity, is the future of our society. And the most important thing, what is for me a transpersonal psychotherapist? A transpersonal psychotherapist is not somebody that identifies a problem and tries to fix it. A transpersonal psychotherapist is somebody that finds what is right and teach the person how to use it. We are educators. We are teachers. We're not therapists. We're not psychologists. We are teachers. We are educating people to think in a different way. So, in certain countries around the world, some people already have taken matters into their own hands. I'm in touch with some of those people. They created their own study groups for children, their own kindergartens, even their own schools, and they're starting from the basis. And the question is to start thinking what kind of world we want to leave behind us for the next generation. What kind of world we want to leave behind us for our children? This is the most important question. Thank you very much.
Thank you, panel. We actually have time because they listened to the sign. Skinner was right, okay? We have time for questions. If there's any questions from the audience or anyone of the panelists, or if any of the panelists have questions for each other. We actually have a few minutes. I don't know if we need to use a mic, but...
Then I'll
a small drink.
I'm here, if it's working, and it's not. Thank you all for your presentation. I appreciate this important topic. Wanted to ask the thoughts from any member of the panel as to what are the promises and pitfalls that we might see from some of the trends in education that we're noticing with regards to for-profit education and online education, how that changes. I know some of you have spoken to the value of presence, and with online education becoming more of the norm, the question is, how do we foster presence if we're not, in fact, able to sit with and be with our students?
Let me talk to especially the second part of what you were raising. Maybe someone else will come in on the first part. I set up an online program in this area of consciousness, transpersonal psychology. I set that up 15 years ago, and I've been teaching online continually, and I'm still teaching a course online. You can be present with people online. That's the first point. I mean, I understand what you're saying, right? That experience of, that a space transforms in some way. You're present with someone in a group, one-to-one, present, face to face, yeah? I understand what you're talking about, but I want to make the case that there are ways of bringing an equivalent online. And of course, I mean, when I started teaching online, there were more restrictions than we have today. Today, it's really very easy to have webinars or to, you know, through voice systems, to have synchronous activity. Certainly, that can bring present. You can be present with people in diverse countries in this system. And I think it's a creative challenge. Now, you know, the question is, are the downsides as strong as I think you were kind of implying? And of course, we can always, with online education, have meetings. I mean, you know, a summer school or some kind of place where you connect, and that's valuable. But I want to disagree with the basic premise. And there's something else, actually, I will just bring in as well. There are obvious strengths to online education. I mean, obviously, you know, I've got students in Australia and Canada and so on. So, you know, obviously that's the point. You can reach, it's a global, I mean, it's not just a cliche word. We're talking about global programs. And people have working commitments and they can't make other times. There's lots of strengths in that way. The one thing that I think, and this maybe links into what I was saying earlier, I'll make it quick. Teaching online challenges me to re-examine the balance between experiential and, if you like, more traditional, more scholarly kind of learning. It challenges me to look at that balance. The last thing I would want to say is that experiential work is not important. Of course it is, there's no question about that. But I think that the way that online challenges me to get the academic, the scholarly content up there and available, I think that's a good challenge.
I'll say something quickly to that. So, I mean, personally, I really like teaching in person, and I think that there's something that, you know, I would miss in that exchange. And at the same time, we do have a number of online programs, and there are really interesting technological solutions for the distance, where there are, like, our online classrooms have video conferencing and breakout rooms and that sort of thing, where you can really mimic some of the elements of an in-person classroom. And it's and while I don't personally use those modalities, I have colleagues who do, and it's always really interesting to hear about what's on the cutting edge of those educational methods.
I have a couple quick points on that also. One is that for me the problem with a for-profit education system is that it is trying to generate efficiency in the denomination of dollars, which is not the denomination of education. With presence, with online education, what I find is in person it's kind of more obvious that I'm able to be present with the students, but with an online education they are required to be more present with me, because each one of them has to respond, and I get to engage with each one of them individually. Finally, the quality of presence that one brings determines the words that you choose. So it's like you read some authors, you know exactly where they are. I mean, that's one of the powers of poetry, is that when you hear it, the way that the words are put together inducts you into the state of the person who was writing the poetry, so that when you are writing it in an online forum or anywhere else, the quality of presence that you bring to the construction of your words will be conveyed to the person, to those who read.
Okay. I'm talking about personal taste, not even an opinion. I have great difficulty with online education, personally. When I go to learn, I go for three reasons. First reason is to meet other people. Second reason is to have fun. Third reason is, by the way, to learn something. We are living, in my opinion, in a very isolated and sad society. The other day in a restaurant, I saw a couple. They were sharing a meal, and each one of them was sitting in their phone and doing something. There was no conversation. There's no communication anymore. We're talking, you know, you don't learn how to drive a car online. And you don't make love by reading the Kama Sutra. Okay? And we need experiential things. We need to be able to touch the human soul. So, yes, we can reach people far away, but we have to be very careful that we don't miss the personal communication. Because, where, in my opinion, where humanity stands today is this lack of personal contact. We're getting more and more isolated. And I'm talking about myself. I sit at night at home. I've got a computer with two screens. I've got Facebook on one screen, Skype on the other screen, and I'm looking if there are any other desperados that are online in the middle of the night.
I would like to share a personal experience. I have nothing to say, really. I have no experience with online teaching, either side. But 30 years ago, I recorded some guided relaxation CDs, and also I gave radio programs with these guided relaxations. And upon the time, you know, the radio had problems and they had to stop these programs. And I was very surprised that I got many, many letters and testimonies and feedbacks from people telling the main thing that they got from me was, they said, about the quality of my presence. I never met them. I never had, you know, any direct feedback with them, and I really was absolutely surprised. This is the only thing I can say, but you know, because I would be a little bit on the US side, but this is what I lived 30 years ago, so.
Thank you, education panel. I'd like to invite the panelists for the practice panel to come on up. As you can see, we will be taking a break after.